Hello, Manchester, and welcome once again to Ward 13. As you can see, your humble host is California Dreaming. And why not? As I backed my car up on a side street, the studio, it kind of plowed a little into a snowbank. Those things are tricky. California Dreaming, our guest today, after we do a little talk about Granite State and national politics, is Lisa, a good friend of mine. Lisa's a housewife from Los Angeles, and she's one of those people you've heard so much about in the media, a person that did not vaccinate their children, one of the dreaded anti-vaxxers. And we're going to talk to her and put a human face on it. It just seems in America, you know, we need witches to be burned. It goes back our puritanical roots. So, Lisa's on the phone. Lisa, do you think of yourself as a witch?
No.
Okay, we're going to talk about, you know, Elvis Presley. Elvis used to live in L.A. a while when he was a movie star. He was actually a top 10 movie star back in the 60s. And then, you know, his career, gave up the movie career, went back to Memphis. And he was definitely the king. You know, Lisa, in the world, there are a few people that could be called the king. Elvis Presley. And who was the king of Hollywood?
Well, that would be Clark Gable.
Definitely, Clark Gable, the greatest movie star there ever was and probably ever will be. And Cary Grant might be a close second. But we're going to talk a little about New Hampshire politics right now, Lisa, then we'll get back to you. We're going to talk about the king of the New Hampshire Democratic party. And we're going to, you can listen in, where he was on, Lisa, he was on Hardball with Chris Matthews, and Chris Matthews asked him whether he would schedule a debate for the Democratic candidates. And let's roll the tape, John. You can listen to his reply.
Raymond Buckley. Mr. Buckley, Mr. Chairman, thank you for joining us. This is Hardball, so I've been pretty nice to the governor, so I'll be tough with you. Should there be, as a matter of principle, debates heading toward the Democratic primary next year, a year from now? Should there be, as a matter of principle, debates?
Well, there have to be more than one candidate to be able to have a debate, and we don't know if there's going to be more than one candidate at this point.
Jim, isn't Webb running?
He hasn't contacted anyone in New Hampshire that I'm aware of.
So you're gonna do this number on me the whole night, right? You're gonna basically say until we have candidate. But as a matter of principle, okay, I'll play your game, Mr. Chairman. You're my guest, so I'll play your game. If there are other candidates, Bernie Sanders or Martin O'Malley, the governor of Maryland, credible candidates, U.S. senators, members of governors who are in office right now, if you have credible people of presidential rank or candidate rank, should there be, as a matter of principle, debates, including Secretary Clinton?
Oh, I'm sure that that the secretary would participate in debates if there were legitimate candidates running. Nobody knows New Hampshire better than Bill and Hillary Clinton. So they understand what it takes to win the New Hampshire primary, and they understand how to communicate and work with it. And they certainly respect the people of New Hampshire. And I would anticipate having a full campaign going on, whether she's opposed here or not.
Well, are you supporting the idea of debates? I'm going to say this to you, answer me. As party chair, do you want to see debates in the New Hampshire primary if there are multiple candidates?
If they're legitimate candidates, sure. And I would be, I assume that she would do that. I can't imagine if they're legitimate opponents.
Why are you so hesitant in the services? There have always been debates in these elections. I grew up with them. There have always been debates. They're the best thing in television. You get a good debate in New Hampshire. Obama makes a stupid remark like she's likable enough, and it turns things around. Reagan says, give me that mic. I paid for it. Don't you want the theater of it at least? Don't you personally want to have some activity in your primary? Are you so afraid of Hillary Clinton and her peeps that you won't just say, damn it, we need to have debates? This is a Democratic Party. We believe in debates. Say it, please.
Well, we don't even know if the secretary has decided to run or not, so it's a little premature.
Okay, let me ask you this. This is absurd. Anyway, can I give a thank you? Anything else you want to tell us? Will there be any activities in the Democratic primary campaign update in addition to debates, since there may not be debates?
Sure. Senator Sanders was here this last weekend having house parties. Okay. Governor O'Malley's coming up in a couple weeks doing a number of local fundraising events.
Thank you. You walked into my trap. There are other candidates. There are other candidates, and therefore you think there should be debates. Anyway, thank you very much, Raymond Buckley. I know where you stand right now. You don't. Anyway, much more to come.
Once again, we had this on my last show. What Chris Matthews said, this is absurd. And Ed Mosca, the former Republican Party chair, said, oh, this might touch off a dust-up in the Democratic Party. Well, there is no dust-up in the Democratic Party because the party belongs to King Ray. I went to the Manchester party meeting, and King Ray put his acolyte in as chair of the party. And it's quite interesting that in New Hampshire, with all the changing demographics, that there was not one African-American, no Latinos that I could see. There was no talk about any outreach to African-Americans or Latinos. You know, I've followed politics since 1968, really, when I was 8 years old in the third grade, and I was a big Bobby Kennedy fan, and my mother would let me stay up and watch the news for the primaries, which were relatively new then, surprisingly. And And on Wednesday, I would tell the kids how Bobby would rack up the victories. We won't talk about the California primary, which was a very traumatic thing. Lisa, what do you think about the New Hampshire primary?
I don't know much about the New Hampshire primary.
Why do you think that a state with 1.3 million people has such power to pick the president, and your state, which has 38 million people, has so little power except for they come out to Silicon Valley and L.A. to raise money? Have you ever seen a presidential candidate?
No, never.
In the 15 years I lived in California, I never met my congressman or a state assemblyman, let alone a senator or a presidential candidate. But here, as you know, we meet them all. I've seen everybody since Lyndon Johnson, with the exception of I was very much a Democrat, and I would not go see Gerald Ford when he visited Manchester in the 1976 primary. So I missed one. But so Ed Mosca, the Republican chair, talked about all this dissent. Well, listen to this. New Hampshire Democratic Party Chair Raymond Buckley, reelected as president of Association of State Democratic Chairs. Unanimously, it's his unprecedented fourth term. There was no opposition. Listen, the whole thing is, they're going to force Hillary onto Democrats. They do not want a primary. It's similar to the year 2000 when the Republican apparatchiks and powers that be rigged things so that George W. Bush would have an easy time, and they handicapped John McCain. And oh, geez, Hillary. Can we see some of those pictures of Hillary? There's been some nasty stuff coming about Hillary. Clinton Foundation received up to $81 million from clients of controversial HSBC Bank. Now, this is there's Hillary with Sammy Sosa, the well-known cheat. They attended Bill Clinton's State of the Union address. This is when Sammy was still a hero. Oh, my God. This is a huge story, HSBC Bank. It's actually having some ramifications here in the United States because it's probably going to it might stop Loretta Lynch from becoming the attorney general because she was handling an HSBC case. You know, they got a non-prosecution agreement.
Hello.
Oh, you still there?
Hello.
Lisa, are you still there? We'll get back. Do you want me to call you back? We'll probably have to call her back. We'll get to... this is a huge story that they helped launder money for the Mexican drug cartels. But one of the most interesting things was when Loretta Lynch negotiated the non-prosecution agreement, they ignored the fact that HSBC helped wealthy Americans. Lisa, are you there? I guess I'm going to call her back. They helped wealthy Americans, HSBC, hide their monies in Swiss numbered accounts, you know, private banking accounts. And it's just one scandal after another. Here's some of the headlines. Hillary State Department okayed Bill's big money speeches. Bill made about $109 million after he left the White House. When Hillary became the Secretary of State, her Secretary of State had her department had to vet when Bill Clinton went out and made speeches to foreign speeches. One of the speech was to what they thought were agents of the Chinese government, and there's such a clear, you know, ethics violation, a conflict of interest. The thing is that the Clinton speeches were, according to the Washington Post and other articles, they were just, you know, quickly allowed, no matter what the ethical questions. Within 3 weeks after Hillary Clinton took office, her husband's office sought approval for three-year consulting arrangements, asking that the State Department ethics officials responded within 5 days. And then we were talking about the millions of dollars from the foundations, from these ethically challenged people. But there's an interesting thing. There's articles that the DNC, which Ray Buckley is a vice chair of, they don't care about all these stories coming about Hillary and about the additional corruption of Hillary and Bill, how they shook the money tree. Ray Buckley's discounted. Oh, they're just bad stories, you know. The fact is the DNC are completely unfazed about this stuff, which are big stories in Europe. They're not being carried so much here. And I'll just tell you, I was with the Whistleblower Center, but this was a separate case from there. A whistleblowing case with Home Depot. It found out, a lawyer found out that Home Depot was charging 10 to 15% for supposedly damaged goods. And a whistleblower alerted the authorities about this because it's corrupt behavior under the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, that anything negative like this, and it came from the top, you know, these chargebacks, that anything that can affect the stock price negatively is illegal, and you can go to court and sue. So they prepared the suit, and they took it to federal court, and what they found out was the stock market already was conscious of this behavior, the analysts. It was already discounted. So the petty and grand corruption of the Clintons has already been discounted by the Democrats, the Democratic National Committee, and they intend to force Hillary on us. They don't want a contested primary. John, can you show that thing about Governor O'Malley? You see, Governor O'Malley's coming back to New Hampshire. He's going to be here on March 7th. He is an undeclared candidate for president, probably running for vice president. So see, there are candidates along with Bernie Sanders. So it just makes nonsense of King Ray. Okay, we have Lisa back from Los Angeles. Let's get on to Lisa. How are you?
Hello. Oh, very good. Thank you.
How is the drought in Los Angeles?
Yeah, we still have a drought. We've had a little more rain this winter than last winter, but definitely in a drought situation. Might have some rain this weekend.
Oh, wonderful. You've heard about the weather we're having here in New England, haven't you?
Oh, God, yeah. Like, Boston is basically shut down.
Oh, it was.
People can't even get to work on time.
You know, the narrow street. We actually have a picture of you with a sweatshirt that had Boston on it. Talk about the irony. Lisa, let's get cut to the chase. Why didn't you get your children? First of all, I'd like to say that you fit the stereotype. You are Phi Beta Kappa from one of the top universities in America. You have a master's degree. You're upper middle class. Why did you not have your children vaccinated?
Well, I heard from this one doctor I came into contact with at a critical point when my first child was very small that the getting those childhood diseases such as chickenpox and mumps and German measles is actually very good for the immune system. It strengthens the immune system for your whole life. And having had those childhood diseases, you carry a certain amount of protection through adulthood for a lot of different things, not just for those diseases, but just a stronger immune system in general.
Stronger than a vaccination?
What?
Now, I had chicken pox, measles, all those diseases. Having chicken pox or measles, actually having it, creates a stronger immunity than you get just from a vaccine?
Well, it creates a lifelong immunity to that
right.
disease, but also your immune system in general is stronger for anything. There's a certain cellular immune system that exists in our bodies that's separate from the blood that produces
right.
antibodies. And this cellular immune system has your white blood cells, the thymus and the spleen and the tonsils are all part of it. The lymphatic system is part of it. This system is strengthened by having disease and overcoming the disease.
Okay, Lisa, next week we're going to have Thomas Massengale back on, a naturopath and homeopath. Maybe we can have you on, too, to talk about that more specific, because we only got about 6 or 7 minutes left. You know, the show goes by fast. We only have a half hour. There was a measles outbreak in Disneyland. Are you rather surprised by the press coverage that, you know, it's almost like they equate this with polio? And just to contextualize, Germany at the same time, which has a 97% measles vaccination rate, has had a breakout that's equivalent to 10 times more than the United States. Yet nobody is particularly perturbed about that. One of the things about vaccines is, you know, like you said, you're not as strengthened as you are. And what do you think about this scapegoating of people like yourself? And like I said, America has long had a history of witch burning, whether it was the witches of Salem, communists, you know, in the 40s and 50s. What do you think about that, the reaction against people that didn't vaccinate their children? Are you an irresponsible parent?
Well, on the one hand, you can make a case that, yes, I am, because I'm putting all of these immune weakened people at risk who can't have the immunizations because their immune systems can't handle them. So the medical profession has finally recognized that not everyone can handle immunizations. If you're immune compromised, you can't get them.
Yes.
So therefore, if I don't immunize my children, then I'm putting these weakened people at risk. But then I counter that with, I can quarantine my children if they do get ill, and I can be responsible in that way, so I'm not putting others at risk. And I'm also helping the society as a whole by allowing my children to get these illnesses and overcome them, because then as adults they won't get the illnesses,
right.
and they won't be putting anyone at risk, you know, because they'll have lifelong immunity to them.
Okay, we got 5 minutes left. Tell us about California. Now, you were actually able to put your children into public schools because there was an exemption for conscience, or, right? And they're considering...
Personal belief.
They're considering getting rid of this, aren't they, in California?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they are, of course. Because people, they don't understand that getting the measles isn't necessarily a death sentence. I mean,
no, it's not.
Far from it. The measles is a disease that most people will get over, and it will have no lifelong effects on them other than lifelong immunity.
Right. And in the Waldorf schools that follow Steiner, Rudolf Steiner, and some of the philosophies, they actually have what are called measles and chicken pox parties. I'll just say one thing. I was shocked to find out that there's a chicken pox vaccine, because I had chicken pox. This is hardly, you know, they're always equating things with polio, you know. Chicken pox. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it's just this general reaction, and maybe it's fueled by drug companies. I don't know. I don't have any evidence. But there's just this idea that we need to wipe out disease, and the more vaccines we can get, the closer we are to wiping out disease, But the problem with that is we no longer get these infectious diseases at the rates we used to because of vaccination.
Right.
They say it's because of vaccination. I don't know. Maybe it's just people don't get them anymore. But then we get cancer instead, which is not infectious. It's just one of these diseases that everybody seems to get nowadays.
Well, what will you do if they take away the exemption for belief? What would you do with, you have one child in public school. What would you do?
Well, I suppose I would try and find a way out of it through other exemptions, you know, or I would just have her immunized, but have a very close consultation with her doctor
right.
about how to do the immunizations very slowly and methodically, and not just give her like you know, DPT, MMR, and whatever else they give, chickenpox and SPV or whatever that thing is, all on the same day, because that's what they do. I mean, they basically just overwhelm you with vaccinations
right.
on this schedule.
Okay, well, Lisa, we're going to have to wrap it up. Could you come back next week and talk to us some more?
It's possible.
Okay, because we are going to have Thomas Massengale back on. We're going to talk about such issues as MMR. And you know that Merck, there are two lawsuits under the False Claims Act working their way through the federal courts for the last 4 years, that Merck, the creator of the marketer of the MMR vaccine, has overstated its efficacy. At, you know, in order, it controls it. It has a monopoly. And there are a lot of issues. But here's the thing. Don't you think that there should be a debate about this, that people like yourself shouldn't be demonized?
Oh, of course.
Right.
But, you know, it's always the minority in any sort of controversy is going to be the demon, right?
Oh, yes. America, you know, my family came here. They were actual real Puritans with names like Moses. They were Puritan ministers. They're potted, you know, south of here. They brought that Puritanism that with them, and there's always a witch to be burned. Well, thank you very much, Lisa. We'll be in contact.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Manchester, thanks once again for visiting Ward 13. Next week, we're going to have Thomas Massengale back, and we're going to discuss the issues of vaccination, and I hope you'll join us then. And I hope you enjoy our new ending. See you next week.
The time has come for us to say sayonara. My heart will always be yours for eternity. I knew sometime we'd have to say sayonara. Please promise that you'll be returning someday to me. I'll remember our romance until the day that I die. I'll see your face in the moon and stars in the sky. So hold me close before you say sayonara. Promise that you'll always keep me